Welcome to the Precious Testimonies broadcast. I'm Norm Rasmussen, your host. In the Old Testament book of Psalm, chapter 96, verse 3, it reads, "Declare God's glory among the nations." Well, Precious Testimonies has been called of God to do just that. And we're to do that by giving born-again Christians an opportunity to share what Jesus has done in their lives to the glory of God the Father and, of course, the Holy Spirit and, of course, Jesus himself. And so with that, we're going to let you hear some people sharing how God has worked in their lives and what this Jesus has done for them and what he means to them. And I pray that this will be something God uses to either help you come to a precious relationship with God or grow in your relationship with God. And with that now, let's listen to what some folks have to say about this great and mighty Savior whose name is Jesus Christ.
Hi, I'm Amy Carmen, and I'm a follower of Christ, and I'm in recovery for drinking, drugs, sex, and codependency. I was born in England, and I went to a Catholic school all my life. When it came to college here in America, my faith just didn't exist. I got really involved in drinking in college, and I had already had sex with multiple people at that point. I had lost my virginity at age 15. I went to the top 10 party school, San Diego State, which was literally all about partying. I went to parties probably 3 or 4 times a week, and I drank about 5 or 6 times a week. I hit a bottom freshman year. I even tried cutting myself once. I have this little mark on my arm. It's a tiny little mark. I'm such a baby when it comes to pain. Like, I never tried that again, but that's how low it got. Fast forward to senior year, I was really, really depressed. I was living with 2 boys. I was in and out of relationships, really just searching for who I was and what I was supposed to be doing in life. And I just really felt like killing myself. I had hit the bottom. I was turning towards these thoughts of suicide, and I even had a plan in my head of how I was going to do it. So I called a friend desperately, someone who I hadn't talked to in a couple of years, and I just said, "Jamie, I don't know what to do. I'm just feeling like a zombie. I'm really scared. I'm having these thoughts." She's like, "You need to go get counseling." So I went to a counseling office, and she was okay. I didn't tell her my deep, dark secrets or anything. We'd pretty much talked about boys the whole time, but she did help me figure out that I wanted to do acting as something in my life. So she was like, "What can you do?" And I was like, "I could do extra work." And so I went on set as an extra for Veronica Mars in San Diego. And on set, I met a friend named Andrew. And Andrew said, "Come to church with me, come to church with me, come to church with me." Every single week, I was like, "I hate church, Andrew. I went to the Catholic church growing up. No offense if you're Catholic, it just wasn't for me." I was forced to go to Catholic church growing up, sit in the front row, listen to my mom sing in the choir, and it just all went over my head. It did not relate to me at all. Finally, one day I was like, "Andrew, just to get you to stop telling me, come to church, I'll come to church with you." So I went to church with him, and I went there, and it was kind of like a new age church. Like, it was young people, there was a rock band, there was even a station where you could make art during the service. I love art, so that really, I was like getting into like the popsicle sticks, making like a Jesus cross, and I was just like, "This is awesome." And the pastor spoke to me, and I said, "Wow, that really hit home. I understand what he's talking about." Fast forward to Easter of that year, and I went to this big Cox Arena ceremony for Easter. And I was sitting there. I brought a friend who wasn't a believer, and I was like, "Oh, maybe I can convince him to be a believer too." But little did I know, I wasn't even a believer at that time. I hadn't quite said yes to God. So I was, I don't know, like the blind leading the blind or something like that. So they come to the part where there's, they call you up and they say, "If you want to give your life to Jesus, stand up. And I stood up thinking everyone else was wanting to give their life to Jesus too, but I guess they had already given their life to Jesus. And so they rush me out and they pray over me and they give me a Bible. And the girl was just, she said things like, wow, Amy is just so beautiful inside and out. And a woman had never said that to me before. And so it really touched me, and I felt loved for the first time, unconditionally. I went home and I cried. And I said, God, thank you so much. I love you, Jesus. And I gave my heart and soul to Jesus that day. Unfortunately, I relapsed, and I went and got into another bad relationship, and I turned back to my old ways of drinking and smoking pot and just doing sinful things. I went to LA shortly after that, and I moved in with the boyfriend that I had, and he even hit me one night, and it was awful. I was starting to hit another bottom. I remember having suicidal thoughts again, and I wasn't going to church. I lived far away from everyone. Finally, I just prayed. That's all I could do. And I said, Jesus, do you want me to quit drinking? I remember it was November 4th, 2008, and I heard, yes, this big booming voice from heaven. And I said, okay, all right, I'll do whatever you say. And honestly, I haven't had a drink from that day, and that is a miracle. I broke up with the boyfriend. I moved in with a friend from church. I started to build my life the way Jesus wanted me to live my life. Unfortunately, that January after November, I relapsed with sex. I had sex with someone who I had sex with in high school, and I just felt so icky. I hadn't drank. It was New Year's, and I said, okay, this is not okay. I don't feel good about this. The next day, I went to church, and I saw somebody, and I said, what is this table that you're standing at? And they're like, this is Celebrate Recovery. And I was like, what's Celebrate Recovery? And they said, it's a program for people with hurts, habits, and hang-ups. And I said, "What? that's what I need." And so they gave me a pamphlet. And then after church, I went to a birthday party. And I whispered to one of my friends, I said, hey, I think I'm going to go to this Celebrate Recovery thing. Do you know anything about it? And she said, I go to Celebrate Recovery. It's my friend Leslie. And she said, come, you'll love it. It's amazing. We really are seeing some miracles happening here. So the following Sunday, I went to Celebrate Recovery, and 2 years later, I graduated from the Celebrate Recovery program. It's technically only supposed to take a year, but since we were the first women's group at our church, it took a little longer. We were the guinea pigs, so to speak. And honestly, I saw everyone get healed. I was healed. I waited to have sex with my husband. I still haven't drank. I'm no longer codependent. I have my own life, my own relationships, and my own relationship with God. I don't turn my husband into God. And I also recently struggled with an Adderall addiction, even after being in recovery. I still struggle with things. It seems like the devil is never done tempting me, and I just know that my story is something that other people can relate to, and I just hear God telling me, share your story, be open and honest, because there's an amazing thing that happens when you're honest with someone. They open up right back. As soon as I share something, I have people telling me their darkest things as well. It's an amazing thing when you speak the truth. The truth can set you free, and Jesus is the truth, and He set me free. Thank you for listening.
Josh is victorious. He's filled with hope, peace in the moment, and excitement about the future. But there was a time when joy and freedom were little more than a desperate, distant dream. I don't even know how I would have even reacted to something like that. Wouldn't they at least give you some details over the telephone?
No, they told me I had to come straight in. They just said it was urgent and that I needed to be there.
I've always, you know, known that you've had medical issues, but I didn't realize it was so serious.
Well, yeah, they've gotten worse and worse over the years, but I mean, it really all started when I was born. You know, I was born with a serious heart defect.
Wow.
And so I had open heart surgery when I was 2 months old, and at that point they put a pacemaker in. So I mean, as far back as I can remember, it's pretty much been surgery after surgery and hospital visits as far back as I can remember.
Wow.
But I mean, because of that, I guess I've always known that Christ was real. I just, until I was 12 or 13, never really took that leap of faith. Huh. You know, I took that leap of faith at retreat when I was 12 years old, and you know, I was on fire for Christ. I went back home and I was bringing my Bible to school and talking to all my friends, and you know, and at that point they pretty much just didn't want to have anything to do with me. They just thought I was a weirdo. So I just got lonelier and lonelier, and there was just a point where I just had had enough, and so to fit in, I just started doing what everyone else was doing. I started smoking weed and drinking, and by the time I was 14, 15, I was selling weed and getting into harder drugs, and just progressed, and I met a buddy who got me into meth, and I got deep into that really quick, and I was smoking it and selling it, and you know, it almost destroyed, you know, everybody I knew. I was watching people die and people go to jail, and so when my dealer went to jail, I decided that it was time for me to get out. But I couldn't quit drinking. I mean, the drinking just stuck with me. And it got to the point where I like couldn't leave the house. I had no friends anymore. I didn't know who I was. I was just miserable. And then I went in for a checkup, and the doctor told me that if I didn't quit drinking, I wasn't going to live the rest of the year.
Sounds like an awful time in your life.
Yeah, I was alone. I was hopeless. I mean, I was just lost. I had nothing to live for, and you know, I felt like there was no one there that could help me.
It sounds like God changed your heart and your mind.
He did. He brought an old friend back into my life that told me about Celebrate Recovery, and I went and checked it out, and to be honest, it's just people like me and you who have hurts, habits, and hang-ups that just believe that Christ can heal them. And you know, I went and checked it out, and I loved it. It was like my family, you know. It was just great people. You know, you won't find anyone that's going to judge you or say anything bad about you. We're all just there to love one another and to just find the root of each other's problems. Well, you know, when I got to Celebrate Recovery, you know, I noticed that they were just like me. You know, they were all struggling, you know, with the same stuff I was struggling with, but they were being victorious where I had failed. And, you know, it was just nice to be able to be invited into that group where, you know, it's just a winning battle. You know, if you just keep showing up and meeting people and talking about your story, you know, it does get better. And now I'm a leader at Celebrate Recovery, and I'm also a youth leader at my church. And you know, you just got to get involved in people's lives each day, and it gets the thought off yourself and onto others.
So how's your health now?
You know, it's been amazing. The doctors can't explain it, and I can't explain it, but last checkup they said that my heart's almost back to normal, and I would say it's a miracle. You know, I'm giving all praise to God.
Well, I'm glad that we were able to get together. I've always wanted to get to know you a little better, and you have an amazing story.
Yeah, God is good, man.
I'm a grateful believer in Jesus Christ, and I struggle with addictions. I want to start with, I've been an addict for 20 years, since the age of 12. I struggled all through my life with acceptance and abandonment issues. It wasn't until I got busted, I ended up incarcerated. I was looking at 12 years in prison. I became eligible for a DET program. That's a drug diversion program. The drug diversion program, they talked a lot about God, and I had no understanding of God. It wasn't until I picked up my kids one afternoon, and my son asked me if I wanted to go to church to have donuts and coffee. I was brought here with the donuts and coffee. I walked through the pews. God touched my heart. I sang along. I started to cry. I didn't know what was going on, but something inside me was changing. I came back. I met a couple people here that I felt really accepted. They listened to me, something that I wasn't used to, and they didn't want nothing from me. I met Scott Dowdy. We started talking about a Celebrate Recovery program. I started to work a program of Celebrate Recovery. I learned so much about myself. I got out of denial. I had a little bit more acceptance. I had no fear. I learned about faith and about God's promises, that God will not leave me or forsake me. There's just so much that I've gotten out of this program. I just graduated my program. They took my felony and took my guilty plea and made it a non-guilty plea. They reduced my felony down to a misdemeanor and dismissed it off my record. And that's by staying faithful to God. I work in a program to Celebrate Recovery. So I just am truly grateful to have God in my life and to have the people around me here at Northeast Assembly that have shown me how to love, how to be compassionate, and how to serve God. I'm honored to be a part of Celebrate Recovery here at this church. And I want to really encourage everybody to be a part of Celebrate Recovery here at this church and to support people like me that struggle. I want to give a special thanks to Scott and Jill Dowdy and Miss Miriam and Steve Laird for showing me that Christ loves.
I grew up in South Florida in a little town, Delray Beach. Happens to be the recovery capital of the world today, but I come from a family of farmers, and I had a really, really idyllic childhood. Family get-togethers on holidays, grandparents' pool on the weekends, that kind of stuff. No alcohol or drug addiction that I knew of back then. And then, when I was about 12 years old, all that changed for me. My parents got divorced when I was about 13, I guess it was. And, it was a hurtful time for all of us. It was during this time that I turned away from God. We were raised in a Christian family. We went to church on the weekends, on Sundays, and Sunday school, and Bible, vacation Bible school, that kind of thing. I had at a young age, I believed in Jesus Christ, and that, he was out there. When my parents got divorced, I remember playing a old 45 record of the Lord's Prayer and setting it on the old record player. For those of you who are younger here, they don't realize what that is, but you can set it so it'll replay. It was the Lord's Prayer, and I would lay down in my bed and curl up in a ball, and I'd just keep playing that song over and over again, wishing God would fix things. And I think that's when I made a decision, although not consciously, to walk away from God. It just happened. I just stopped going to him, and I think it must have been that I was thinking he wasn't answering my prayers. So why bother? If there was a God, he sure wasn't doing anything for me. At least that's what I thought. This is when I began hanging out with the wrong people and started drinking, using drugs, smoking cigarettes. And by the time I was 18, I'd failed the first semester of 11th grade and was sent to military school to straighten me out, and that didn't work. I'd wrecked in total two cars, and I had two DUIs on two separate incidences, and a friend of mine had taken his own life, and that was all by the time I was 18. I was living in my van because I was no longer allowed to live at home because of my behavior. I remember there was one instance, though, when I'd been out partying all night. I woke up the next morning and I couldn't remember where my car was, where my car keys were, my wallet was gone. And I remember searching my pants pocket and I found just one piece of paper in there, and it was the poem with the footprints on it. And, you know, to this day, that still has an impact on me. I thought about it then, and I thought maybe, you know, God was reaching out to me then, and more of that will become clear later on in my story, but it's always been kind of special to me. I don't know to this day how it got there. During that time, I had been able to not only keep a job as a cook, but actually was pretty good at it, and through some connections of my dad, I moved to Virginia Beach, Virginia, and took a job under an Italian chef at a restaurant there. That's where I added another addiction, and I started gambling. The owner of the restaurant and his associates were heavily involved in gambling, and I began not only gambling, but collecting and paying off for the bookmakers. I dated the owner's daughter, Maria, for a little while. It didn't really go anywhere. And not long after that, she was murdered in a bad drug deal. I also met my ex-wife while I was working there, and we were married. I was 21 years old. That marriage ended years later due to my drinking and drugging and also my gambling and my infidelities. And there's another thing I need to mention here as part of my story, and that's the fact that we decided to abort twice, once before we were married and once after. And that decision is something that still weighs heavy on my heart. I left that restaurant after 5 years to go to another in Virginia Beach, and where I continued on with my daily drinking and drugging for 2 more years. And then I decided I wanted to be better at what I did, so I went to culinary school in France, and I spent 6 months over there. After that, I moved to Washington, D.C., and got a job working next door to the White House for a year. And then one of the owners of the restaurants I'd worked at before in Virginia Beach offered me a partnership deal, and I took that and moved back to Virginia Beach. During all those moves, I continued in all my addictions. I drank around the clock pretty much, continued to use drugs, and was somehow able to maintain. Looking back, I don't know how I did it. Although I was still married, my marriage was suffering tremendously due to my lifestyle and my infidelities. And my wife and I left that partnership and opened our own restaurant. And not long after that, I ended up in my first treatment center. And I was being forced into there by my wife and by the gentleman that had backed me and loaned me the money to open my restaurant. And they knew I was in trouble and I was out of control because I'd disappear for days at a time and, you know, on an alcohol or cocaine binge or whatever. I got out of treatment and soon relapsed. That whole restaurant lifestyle was not healthy. My wife and my backer had both had enough by this time. And my marriage and my restaurant was taken from me all in one swift moment one day. And, you know, they would have thought that might have been a wake-up call, but I thought about God at that point. You know, I was at one of my lowest points, and I had been to a place in North Carolina when I was a kid as a camper, you know, boys camp, and I'd always felt close to God there. So I knew a nice Christian couple there, and I went to them, and they let me live there for about a year. And I lived in a little cabin there with no windows or electricity, just had a little cold water running tap out front, and it was me and my dog, and I went there to find God, so to speak. But I continued using and drinking and drugging, and you know, there was times when I only had enough money to buy dog food and alcohol and drugs. I didn't have enough money for food for me. And, you know, I remember sitting there and eating puppy chow and chasing it with a shot of vodka or something. I got another DUI there. I had borrowed a friend's car and rolled it off the mountain. And I knew I was going to be in trouble, so I left the scene of the accident and got back home, ran back home. I wasn't that far from the house. And I had a moped, so I got on a moped and I went back to check out the crash scene, you know, like a real bright individual. so they couldn't prove the wreck on me, but they gave me a DUI driving on a moped. Story of my life, honest to God. And, you know, right after that, I hit bottom really hard, and I knew I needed help. And I called home, and my mom sent me a ticket home, and I checked into my second treatment center in South Florida. And I got sober for a little while, and I got a job working for MetLife selling life insurance, and I relapsed again. And I began living out of my car and out of my office. And I got another DUI when I ran into somebody head-on and caused them serious bodily injury. And I knew I was in serious trouble this time. And I immediately checked myself into treatment. I got 5 years probation and no jail time that time. And I actually got sober this time for a little while. Started going to AA regularly, and I was working as a roofer with a bunch of other guys in recovery, and my life started getting better. I wasn't really working any kind of program. I had a sponsor. I was hanging around people in recovery, but I really wasn't. I did some work on my steps, but I really didn't get in and dig around. I did half measures avail us nothing. You know, the big book talks about that, and that was what I was doing. I did a half attempt at a fourth step and fifth step, and you know, I continued on like that. And about 3 years sober, let me back up a little bit. Women have always been another one of my addictions. I tend to go there to make me feel better. So throughout my whole life, I was always, you know, chasing women, and that was part of my story. So, but anyway, in recovery, I was doing the same thing, and I met this girl about 3 years sober, and I fell in love. Thought I did anyway, and I had no higher power but her. I put her before everything else I did, and she decided that I was too crazy and too nuts. And I went to codependency treatment at 4.5 years sober to figure out how to fix her. And that didn't work either. So with about 3 days left on my 5 years of probation, and I was in a lot of emotional pain, I drank, I got drunk, and make matters worse, I got another DUI when I ran into the back of a policeman. They sentenced me to 6.5 years in prison for a violation of probation and DUI. And I spent most of my time down in Miami at Everglades, maximum security down there. I know there's one gentleman here tonight who's been there. He knows where it is. And you know, it wasn't a very, very good time in my life. And then to make matters worse, while I was in there, Roberta took her own life. I served 3.5 years on a 6.5 year sentence. I was transferred to work release at West Palm Beach. And, you know, while I was in prison, too, I mentioned this, too, I stayed sober in prison. And there's plenty of opportunities to do alcohol and drugs, but I did stay sober in there. And I reached out to God, and I believe he was with me the whole time I was in there. And I attended my AA meetings in there, and I attended my first Kairos weekend in there as a participant then. So anyway, when they transferred me to West Palm, I got a job working with Publix. Publix hired me in work release as a deli associate. And I transferred up here to Tallahassee to be closer to family. My mom and my sister live here. And I was actually released from prison on May 4th, 2000. And then I transferred up here to Tallahassee. I went to meetings for a little while. I never did go to church really much, and I just started slacking off and feeling like I was doing okay. You know, I was going to work like I was supposed to, trying to maintain, wasn't really drinking or drugging. I had bought a house, feeling like, you know, I can maybe have a beer or two. And surely smoking a joint's not going to hurt me. And it wasn't long, and I was drinking around the clock, smoking dope, and I had to sell my house or be foreclosed on because I was drinking and smoking all the house payments. Well, I was decided it was time for me to move to Colorado, and one of those geographical cures again. And I got a job on a ranch out there, and you know, I had about 5 years in with Publix at that time. I left on good terms and had a little bit of retirement, so I went out there and I spent a couple of years out there. And basically what I did out there was drink and drug. And, you know, I rode horses and I had a blast, and I didn't have any consequences because I wasn't driving, and except horses. And even they hurt sometimes when you don't stay on them like you're supposed to. But my drinking continued. I got another downward spiral, and I knew I was in trouble again. So, you know, my natural instinct was to call home, and once again, I called Publix, and they hired me back. And about a month later, I came back to Tallahassee, and Publix had rehired me. You know, I continued to drink when I got back from Colorado, and I tried to control it, and although I did for some time, I didn't do it very well. And in 2011, when I had another 4 years in with Publix again, I started another downward spiral, and I started drinking on my lunch breaks, and I was confronted with it at work, and I was suspended, and I went checked into another treatment center out in California. That was my fourth treatment center, and I did that to save my job. You know, that treatment center was good for me. It's where I got introduced to Celebrate Recovery. I also had a couple of Christian counselors there that were able to show me about all the hurt and unforgiveness that I was carrying around in my heart, and you know, the resentments that I wasn't ever able to really see before. You know, one of those Christian counselors is still a friend of mine today. We message back and forth on Facebook all the time, but they really helped me a lot. And you know, when I came back from treatment, I walked through the doors of Celebrate Recovery here at KUMC my very first time. And I knew right then there was something special about this place. I wish I could say I never drank it again, but I did. I was really having trouble fitting in, and my social skills were not the greatest. I again started on a downward spiral, and I had to check into detox again at TMH. And I was really feeling hopeless at this point. I had tried everything that I knew to fight against my disease, and I failed. And nothing I had done had worked. You know, AA talks about that incomprehensible demoralization and about those who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. And, you know, I thought for certain that I must be one of those, that I wasn't going to get this. You know, I didn't want to live anymore. I was afraid to die. I just wanted to stop hurting. So I decided to go to my fifth treatment center. It was outpatient at TMH, where the whole purpose of that was to help build a support group, which I had never really done before. So I said, well, I had the choice of going inpatient or outpatient. I took the outpatient because I'd never really built a support group before. And I started going back to AA, and I started coming to CR, and I started asking for around for a sponsor. And somebody suggested this really big, tall guy. And I knew his wife because she got up here and gave all those crazy jokes and announcements and stuff like that. But I didn't know him, and I saw him the next morning, Sunday morning at a coffee pot, and he told you the rest of the story. I went up to him, I said, you know, somebody suggested I talk to you, I really need a sponsor. And that's what he said. I got one opening 7 a.m. Sunday morning. I said, all right, I'll take it. Now, you know, I was ready, I really was. I just didn't know what else to do. I was ready to throw the towel in. I was ready to surrender it all. And I've been seeing Lonnie for over a year and a half every Sunday morning since then. And it's the most special time of my week. I look forward to it. You know, it started out as an hour, and we a lot of mornings now have trouble getting through in an hour and a half. We could sit and talk all day, and he's just been a true blessing in my life, a true friend in my life. You know, and one of the things I always struggled with was my faith. And from the time I walked away from God as a kid, I'd always had my doubts about God and if there even was a God. And I felt like he sure hadn't done anything for me, and all those times I cried out to him and to get me out of this one or that one, you know, whatever. So Lonnie started sharing with me about his faith and what God had done in his life. And he also suggested I read some things by Sam Shoemaker, who was a priest with the Calvary Episcopal Church in New York City, where the headquarters for the Oxford Group was. Sam Shoemaker and the Oxford Group were a real significant influence on Bill Wilson, who was a co-founder with Dr. Bob for Alcoholics Anonymous. And in one of Sam's books called Extraordinary Living for Ordinary Men, he has a chapter in there called How to Find Faith, Steps for the Honest Doubter. And it just jumped off the page at me. He talks about Jesus' disciple Thomas, who said he would never believe until he stuck his fingers in the holes in Jesus' hands. And he goes on to tell how to break out of that circle of skepticism and unbelief. And the first step in admitting that you would, first step is admitting that you want to believe. The second step when finding faith is to go where faith is, to surround yourself with those who have it. And the third thing is Bible study. And the fourth thing, which really got my attention, was to begin a spiritual experiment in your own life. He said, begin by reading your Bible, begin by going to church, begin acting as if God were, by praying. And if you first awake in the morning and you do that, and you tell God what you're feeling, you tell him how you're feeling, tell him you're feeling doubt, be honest with him, call on him throughout the day, and ask him to use you this day and to guide you in working out your problems. And then you act. And he says, not much will happen when you remain on dead center. You got to get off dead center and follow the line of the best light. And you do the obvious next right thing. And then you let God lead you to the inspired thing. He said, get in motion. You can't guide a bicycle leaning against a wall. You can only guide a bicycle that's in motion. Better to step out and make a mistake and really get in motion and let God get at you to correct the mistake. You know, and that kind of really struck me. You know, he goes on to say, and this really moves me when I read this, because it gave me an idea of a God that I had never pictured before. And that's, faith does not believe in a God who just exists, but in a God who lives and loves and reaches out to man and down to him, helping him with his life, guiding him, strengthening him, and using him. Real faith begins when we surrender ourselves to that God who manifested himself in Christ, giving as much of ourselves as we can to as much of him as we know. You know, I tried that experiment, and I truly know God's walking with me today. That's the honest to God truth. I followed Lonnie's and Sam's suggestions, and I did the experiment, and my life is just, I can't even put it into words on what's happened in my life since I walked through these doors. It's different today. I'm different today. It's not about me anymore. You know, all of my family relationships have been restored. My mom, who's here tonight, God bless her, she used to drive from here to Miami to visit me in prison, stayed up countless nights and just praying and worrying about me. You know, my mom, my dad, my brothers, my sisters, all those relationships have been restored. My relationships with all of the people that I pretty much hurt in my life, friends that I got sober with back in the 80s, are friends of mine now, through Facebook and other, actually one of them called last week, is coming up here to visit. But you know, God has restored all those relationships, and he's done a lot of other things for me. Back in December, well, let me preface that. Lonnie got me involved in prison ministry too when I was newly sober, and I started going and volunteering in prisons when I was just a few months sober, with Kairos and with Celebrate Recovery Inside. And that's been over a year and a half, not quite a year and a half ago, I guess. And you know, it was one of the most moving things that's ever happened to me, to be able to go in and tell these guys in there what God's done for me, and to see the light come on in them, and to see that hope that they didn't have before. You know, and God has used the most terrible things that happened to me in my life, like my prison time, and turned them into my biggest assets today. You know, what I'm doing today, I couldn't do without have spent that time in prison. He's taken that and used it as the best asset in my life. Back in December, to follow God's calling on my heart, I left Publix. I had another over five years in with them. I left on real good terms. And I did it to help co-found a nonprofit organization called The Living Harvest, which a number of people in here have come alongside and helped me with. It's a transitional housing program for men getting out of prison that are lost, that we want to help successfully make that transition. Our mission is to help them come to know Christ and to re-enter our community successful and lead purposeful, meaning lives in recovery and in service to God and others. You know, I want to thank Pastor Bob Tyndale, who's here tonight, and Lonnie and Sharon and Dick and Connie and Clay and Jeff and Chris, all those people who have helped me so much with that. And, you know, I'm proud to say that God's given us a house on the south side over there that we have fully furnished now that we can hold eight gentlemen in. And we're working on doing some other things with a thrift store and some car detailing businesses and stuff like that to help support the ministry. And, you know, we're hoping that we'll be able to get the doors open real soon. Another one of the turning points in my recovery has been the steps. And I can't say enough about the steps and the step studies that I've been through. I've been through a number of step studies now. And that's what was able to help me look at all the unforgiveness and the selfishness and the self-centeredness and everything that was inside of me, and it provided a way for me to get rid of all that stuff to make room for God. And I believe that's what the steps do. There are guidelines to bring us back into relationship with Jesus Christ. And if we do those steps, I've seen it transforms people. It really does. And I'm just one of those people that I see it happen every single day. Looking back on my life, I see how God was with me all the time. You know, I mentioned earlier about the footprints poem, and you know, one of the other things, one of my favorite life verses is Jeremiah 29:11, and that's, "For I know what I have planned for you, says the Lord. I have plans to prosper you, not to harm you. I have plans to give you a future filled with hope." And for those of you who've never heard the footprints poem, I want to leave you with that tonight. Because as I look back over my life, I realize that God was with me the whole way through. It says, "One night I had a dream. I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord. And across the sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand. One belonged to me and the other to the Lord. And when the last scene of my life flashed before us, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. And I noticed that many times along the path of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I also noticed that it happened at the very lowest and saddest times in my life. And this really bothered me, and I questioned the Lord about it. I said, 'Lord, you said that once I decided to follow you, you would walk with me all the way. But I've noticed that during the most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why in times when I needed you the most, you should leave me.' And the Lord replied, 'My precious, precious child, I love you. I would never, never leave you. And during your times of trial and suffering, when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you.'" You know, a new friend of mine tonight who couldn't make it tonight, I asked him to come. He said he couldn't make it, but he told me to leave you with this. He said, "Give them heaven." And if I've helped do that tonight for one person, then it's been worth it. Thank you. God bless you. I love you.
I was diagnosed with depression, so I was put on a depression medication, and then I had some physical complications and I had surgery. Before I knew it, I was on 13 different medications. 8 of them were addictive, and I wanted more. About 10 years ago, things started spiraling out of control. About 5 years ago, I started searching for a way back to a relationship with Christ. My family started falling apart, and I just couldn't seem to walk away from the medication, and I kind of gave up and decided that my family would probably be better off without me. So I made a lot of really, really bad choices, and my addictions grew, and my choices grew worse, and in the end I lost my husband. I lost my 3 older children, didn't want to have anything to do with me. About a year and a half ago, I filed for divorce and I left him, and I took the 2 younger girls, and it really kind of destroyed his world. Before I knew it, I had my 2 daughters and we were homeless, and I was drinking so much because I just wanted to kill the pain, and it didn't work. I hit my knees in my kitchen and just cried out to God. And the one word he said was stop. That's all he said was stop. So I stopped drinking, and I stopped running around, and I just stopped. And I started just communicating with God. I met a lady named Debbie Burkhead, who was a leader and a counselor in the Reformers Unanimous chapter there in Pasco. She said she loved me. And I said, let me tell you who I am. And I told her all about myself. And she said she still loved me. And she said God still loved me too. That I couldn't understand. And my husband never did give up. We decided that we'd make it work. I'm off all the medications now. And I just give God all the glory. He's so amazing, and I have a relationship with him that I've never had, that I never imagined having. I hear him. I hear him every day when I get up and have my devotions. So God has restored so many things in my life. I continue to pray for the restoration of the rest of my family, but I've hurt them a lot. And I understand that. I have time. I have time to wait. I have a great relationship with God now that I just so look forward to going back and sharing the gospel like never before with those who need him, those who are addicted.
Be here tonight. My name's Jeff Matthews, and I'm a believer in Christ who is recovering from alcoholism, sexual addictions, and I'm still struggling with overeating. You know, as I talk tonight, you know, some of you may be able to identify with bits and pieces of my story. Some of you may identify with my whole story. What I really want to share specifically about is how Jesus has affected all of my relationships since coming to know him and getting sober. I've had discussions about whether alcoholism is a disease or a decision. And I don't believe that any of my comments tonight will make a definitive argument for either case. And frankly, I don't care. The answer doesn't change anything about what I have to do to live the life that God has set before me. I do know that I am unable to drink like a normal person, in quotes. And in fact, I have never been normal with regard to the use of alcohol. In fact, I am finding that I seem to be unable to do most things in a normal manner. If I like it, I seem to do it until it hurts before figuring out that I need to stop. I had my first drink of alcohol that I can remember somewhere around 10 years old. Not enough to get me really drunk, just enough to allow me to feel the buzz. I have to tell you, I liked it. As I was thinking about it, it came to me that even for that first time of drinking alcohol, I was able to overcome the taste to get to the effect. And I didn't suffer any hangover the next day, which proved to be a pattern for my drinking career later on. I didn't partake of any other alcohol for another 5 or 6 years until I was about 16. You know, so I was really waited a long time before I drank again. And the funny part is that I didn't miss drinking that at that point, and it didn't consume my thoughts or run my life. I went through school with decent grades, took advanced classes, and was generally one of those kids that wasn't a problem to the adults, and I was a square with regard to my peers and generally did what it took to get the "he's such a good boy" compliments and acknowledgments from the teachers and parents of my friends. My parents and I moved to Vancouver, Washington, and I started my 9th grade year. I was starting to desire to be one of the cool people that did the stuff like smoking and hanging out across from the school in the field where all the cool kids hung out after school. I learned to smoke. Again, I was able to get through the dislike of the taste and coughing to obtain the cool factor. And at about this time, I also tried marijuana for the first time. And again, I overcame the coughing and taste to get to the effect. See, are you starting to see a pattern here? I got to spend some time with my cousin from my dad's side. He was about my age, a year or so older, and he had a sister that was 2 years older than him. They lived in Portland, Oregon, and I still remember that particular day that my drinking career got started. Really, restarted is a better word for it. I don't know how many of you can remember your first time getting drunk, taking your first drug, having your first time having sex, or whatever it may be. But I can tell you almost everything about that Saturday afternoon when I became 10 feet tall and bulletproof. It was a fall day. It was kind of crisp. The beer was room temperature, left over from a party that my cousin had attended the night before. It was Olympia beer, and it made me feel wonderful. I don't remember the taste, only the feeling. I was no longer embarrassed to be me. My looks didn't matter, and what you thought of me didn't matter either. We didn't get caught, no one got in trouble, and I didn't see any reason to not do this again. As I'm looking back with some years of sobriety in place, I can see where the disease had continued to progress during the years that I didn't drink. I picked up drinking like I had much experience at it, and I always wanted more. I didn't like the fact that when I smoked pot, I couldn't maintain my composure as easily as when around my parents or teachers, so my drug use was limited. I did figure out how to water down my parents' liquor bottles and make suicide punch, a mix of everything in the liquor cabinet, which tasted nasty, but absolutely had the desired effect. I practiced how to be drunk and enjoy the buzz without letting teachers and parents know what was going on. As I went through high school, getting drunk and attending basketball games, dances, and other school functions became the normal Friday night activity. As a sophomore, I took a printing class at a local community college for one of my elective credits, and rather than ride the bus to class, I started riding with one of the other guys in the class, and we started drinking Old English malt liquor on the way to class. Boy, it made the class go quicker and made it way more interesting. I took my final exam in that class while I was hammered. By the way, I got an A on that test in spite of being drunk. During this time, I did dabble in drugs, and I actually started my own business, buying lids of pot for $7 an ounce and rolling joints for resale. So I learned the concept of supply and demand and how to make a profit carry forward into the next transactions, skills that I use to this very day in the business that my wife and I run. This is probably one of the most useful things I learned in school. I continued to drink at every opportunity from this point forward. I was constantly planning how to get alcohol and where the next party was going to be. I practiced drinking and driving as I had to drive to where the parties were. And since I was sneaking out of the house most of the time, I had to make sure I got home and back in bed quietly each night. I practiced driving in a small town in Northern California late at night where the 10 o'clock curfew for minors driving into the town at 10 o'clock at night where there was a 10 o'clock curfew with one eye open because I was seeing too many options for lanes to drive in. And the cops used to hang out right behind the Welcome to Fortuna sign just inside the city limits, waiting for speeders to come off the Highway 101 into town. So I had to be sure I straightened up and flew right as I passed them. This set the stage for my drinking and how I drank for the rest of my drinking career. I became the designated drunk driver as life went on. The reason for telling you about how it all started and what it was like is to show how easily alcoholism seems to start in those of us who are susceptible to the disease. At least I know it grabbed me from the very first time I drank. I know people that can drink heavily for an occasion and not have any thoughts about drinking again the next day. I can state unequivocally that is not me. So let's fast forward to 1974, and I'm graduating high school, and I'm working at a McDonald's restaurant. Since I was old enough to close, I worked on the closing crew on weekends. And our routine was to have a drinking party at somebody's apartment every Friday and Saturday night after closing. Across the street was a Taco Bell. And since they closed later than us, and the girls working there had really short skirts as part of their uniforms, we started making friends with them and helping them to close up and get cleaned up so that we could invite them to our parties. I didn't know it at the time, but I was chatting up my future wife. By the way, Lisa looked absolutely hot in her uniform. She was the best of the bunch. But I, of course, was attracted to her wonderful personality and tender heart. Long and short, we got engaged to be married on July 4th, 1974. Got married December 7th of that same year. And we just celebrated 37 years of marriage in December. (Clears throat) 37 years all with the same people. I mean, you know, it was so. We moved to Los Angeles, where I was working as a hydraulic mechanic We moved to Los Angeles, where I was working at a hydraulics company as a service mechanic. The other mechanics, at least the good ones, were all heavy drinkers, so I was able to jump right in and be one of the guys and learn many deep and important things during the drinking sessions after work. I was totally engaged in building my career and learning what it took to succeed with no regard for Lisa's desires or needs. This building my career theme became a driving desire and distraction in my relationship with Lisa for many years to come. Somehow during this time, we managed to have a son, move back to the Bay Area and buy a house, lose a child during pregnancy, and then have another son. During this time, I worked a ton of overtime and started drinking daily. I was physically and emotionally unavailable to my wife for the intimacy necessary to build a strong marriage. And I was unavailable for my sons to give them a proper role model of what a father should be. As a follow-up note to this, Lisa and I have gone back and completed the grieving for Christopher Paul and are thankful that he is in God's hands. This has only been possible for me because of the relationship with God that has come out of my sobriety. My daily drinking progressed to drinking straight tequila, as I thought it was easier to hide the drinking because I didn't have to drink as much volume to get the effect. Common theme in my drinking has always been the effect. I began to have consequences with my wife from my drinking and was losing the ability to control how drunk I would get when I drank. The times where I would get blasted and not be able to keep my commitments with my wife and family were getting to be a weekly event. I was trying the various ways to be able to continue to drink, and they weren't working. My periods of not drinking were spent counting the time until I could drink again, and I was angry and resentful the whole time. I was doing everything that I thought a man was supposed to do and fully believed that I was responsible for myself and what was going to happen in my life. As far as I went, there was no God, and I sure didn't need one. I had control of my life, and if it was to be, it was up to me. You could believe in God if you needed to, but I didn't need that crutch. During this time, I started to understand that I was unable to control my drinking, and the self-loathing that came from being weak with regard to drinking was starting to show up every day. I would wake up and think, I'm not going to drink today. And at the end of the day, I would find myself pulling into the liquor store parking lot, cussing myself out, in my head anyway, hating myself all the way up to when the first swig of tequila would go down my throat. Then the self-talk would stop, and all was okay till tomorrow. In our 20th year of marriage, Lisa and I were pretty much toast as far as the marriage went. She was doing everything she could to get me to quit drinking, and I wasn't going to let her control me. I was willing to let her leave if that was what she needed to do, but I wasn't going to let her control me. I knew in the back of my mind that at some point, I would be a non-drinker. I just didn't know when or why. And just as importantly, I didn't know what kind of a person I would be when I got sober. So I screwed up again, got too drunk, and was unable to do something I was supposed to do. But I don't remember what that was. And I made a rash promise to Lisa that I would attend an AA meeting. On the day I was to attend my first meeting, at the end of the day, I went ahead and drank my daily dose of tequila and called Lisa to tell her that I had too much paperwork to get done and that I would go to that meeting tomorrow. For you married men, I suspect that God talks to you pretty frequently, and whether you know it or not, he sounds a lot like your wife. I know that that was the case for me, and it is the case for me and James Dobson. She asked me, why wasn't I being a man of honor and doing what I said I would do? Somehow, and I know now that it was God, those words hit my nerves, and I went to a later meeting that night. Of course, attending the meeting drunk, I had nothing in common with those losers in that room. So at the end of the meeting, I stopped at the liquor store on my way home. I got a couple of additional bottles of tequila, little mini bottles, for that long 3-mile drive home. I got home, and I was laying in bed with Lisa, telling her how this AA thing really wasn't going to for me, and it probably wouldn't work. But for her, I would go to another meeting. As Lisa and I have compared notes later on, I found out that it was at that time, while we were laying there in bed, when I said those words to her, she, in her head and in her heart, gave up on me. And she told God he was going to have to deal with me. She couldn't do it. What I experienced was a feeling of total hopelessness and despair, unlike anything I had ever experienced, which caused a pain in the middle of my chest and brought me to uncontrollable tears and crying for the next 30 to 40 minutes. This was totally unlike me. I hadn't cried in the 20 years of our marriage, and probably not for many years before the marriage. After all, real men don't cry, right? What I know today was that God was using that time to show me the God-sized hole in my soul and preparing me to start seeking relationship with him. What ended up happening was that I started attending AA meetings sober on October 11th, which was the next day, 1994, and I have not had to take a drink or a recreational drug since that day. My wife took me to see an elder at her church, and he convinced me that there might be a God, and that if I would ask him, he would help me stay sober and grow in relationship with him. So as I asked for God to help me in the next few days, at the points where I had a decision to make regarding either stopping to get a drink or passing by the liquor store and going home and staying sober, I was able to go home sober and not have the resentments and anger that I used to have. His response to my simple request started me to believe in him and to actively seek relationship with him. That led me to start attending church to increase the spiritual aspect of my recovery. AA taught me to get in service, so I became involved with the church, which helped me to grow closer to God and eventually Jesus Christ, my Savior. The verse that grabbed me early in sobriety is Joshua 24:15, which tells me that I get to choose who I'm going to follow today. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. It's Joshua 24:15. God was very gentle and very faithful with me in early sobriety, giving me a tingle up my back when I would ask him for help, just to let me know he was there, and removing the anger that would have been seething under the surface for so many years. I had not realized just how permanently pissed off I was for so many years. It just seemed like everyone was out to mess up my plans, and I didn't like it. A saying that I heard in AA, usually just before laughing at someone who was mad about what something they had thought was mad about, something that they had thought they were mistreated about, was, "Don't you know who I am?" I found myself asking myself this question as I was driving, and people weren't driving the way I would have them drive, or they had the nerve to cut in front of me to get on the freeway, or worse yet, they didn't alternate when merging onto the freeway, you know, sometimes going two cars at a time. The difference was I was able to start laughing at myself more than I was ever able to in the past, because God was giving me a new identity, one that was no longer based on anyone else knowing who I was, only that I know who I was in the eyes of the only one that matters, God. Here's how my fights with Lisa usually went. I would make some stupid comment about something she either did or didn't do. After all, didn't she know who she was dealing with? She would respond in a defensive manner, and the battle was on. It now became my duty to win this battle at any cost. I might even know that I was wrong, and I was still determined to say that whatever it took to win, her feelings or emotions were of no concern. When I got into sobriety and started seeking a higher power, God, what ended up happening at those arguments was that while they would start the same, I wouldn't keep up the fight like I used to. Instead, I would cut and run to a meeting where I would find some peace and serenity with God. I would return home in an hour or two and be in a place to offer an apology or an amends and ask for forgiveness for not treating her with the respect and love that God was showing me she was supposed to get from me. I didn't use exactly those words, but the sentiment was there. You can imagine the positive change that had on Lisa's and my relationship in a pretty short time. An example of how God was working on me was one time driving from a job site in a 35-mile-an-hour residential area. I was following some lady who was only driving 35. Imagine that. She was only driving the speed limit, and I was driving 50 so that I could make the light at the corner. Of course, I was stuck behind her at the light that we didn't make. So I was ranting and raving about her, her driving skills, habits, and any other character defect I could think of. In fact, I think I was reciting her genealogy when God chose to reveal himself to me again. I heard a voice, just like someone was sitting in the empty passenger seat, tell me that I had no right to talk about one of God's kids that way. The voice was neither angry nor even loud, but it spoke with total authority. I felt the anger just drain out of me, and tears of gratitude started flowing. As I knew where this came from, and I was grateful for the rebuke. All this time in early sobriety, my relationship was with God. Me and God, you know, we're hooked up. I don't need this Jesus guy getting in the way of my relationship with God. It wasn't until about 2 years of sobriety when I started to deal with the Jesus issue. It wasn't because of any particular crisis, but because he kept popping up and needing to be addressed in my spiritual life. He just wouldn't go away. I attended a week-long retreat that was focused on breaking through the strongholds that hinder our relationship with Jesus. And I must say, this was the most frustrating, draining week that I could remember for a long time. I just didn't get it. Everyone else was getting it, but I just couldn't understand how Jesus and God could love me with some of the things I had done and was still doing. My porn addiction had started back up by this time, and it wasn't until the evening before we were scheduled to leave that Jesus was able to get through the debris in my head and help me to know who he is. I didn't fully realize how big that would be in my life and relationships until Monday morning when I was telling Lisa about my experiences at the retreat. And I found myself in tears and unable to speak when I started to tell her about what Jesus meant to me and how he fit into the salvation picture for me. That is when my faith became rock solid and unshakable. I don't claim to understand why God would do what he did for a jerk like me, but I know with every fiber of my being that he did it, and there's no turning back for me. I may wander in the desert sometimes, but he is faithful to lead me out as soon as I start following his directions. Somewhere in my second or third year of sobriety, it came to light that our oldest son was using drugs and there were other issues going on. My reaction was to seek God for what to do. That was the right decision. My next one wasn't quite as right. Instead of staying tuned to what God wanted to do, Lisa and I did what we always did. We fixed him. And we fixed him. And we fixed him. And we fixed him, and so on. The problem was that he kept breaking, or at least that's what we thought. What we finally figured out was that we kept getting in the way of what God wanted to do in our son. So we took the discipline that was meant for him. So we were stopping God from doing the work he desired to do in our son. We finally got the message and made the hard steps. Fired him from my business twice. Had him move out. in and out of the house a few times, and then finally telling him he was no longer allowed to live at our house. I physically locked him out of the house when the deadline came and he hadn't taken his stuff. We were prepared for him to be homeless and sleeping under a bridge if that was what it would take for God to do his work. Didn't get to that point, but our son wore out his welcome at almost all of his relatives and family before getting into recovery and finding a God in his life. Approximately 8 years ago, someone told Lisa and me about a program called Celebrate Recovery that was based on the 12 steps of AA, with the difference being that the higher power is clearly defined as Jesus Christ, our Savior. We attended an introductory seminar, the one-day seminar that they just had in Sacramento this last weekend. Came away from that day totally on fire for the program and wanting to see it happen in our spheres of influence. The recovery that was available for not only the alcoholic and the Al-Anon, but the other people that have been hurt or have life-destroying habits was totally attractive to us. We met with some others who had attended the training, and we decided to start a CR at our church. Before starting our meeting, we attended several other existing meetings in the area to see how well it worked, and we were constantly blown away by the recovery we found in each of these places. It's places like this. So we started a step study at our church, and we started attending a Friday night meeting at Harbor Light Church in Fremont. You know, I've gone through the CR steps about four times now, and each time I'm finding new things and deeper issues that I'm working on recovery from. You may have noticed that I claimed recovery from sexual addiction at the beginning of this share. It has only been in the last year or so that it was made clear to me that I had some issues from the past that needed to be brought to light and given away to Jesus so that I can be totally free from any bondage in that area. I must tell you that the process of consciously surrendering these past sins to Jesus has been tremendously freeing to me. It confirms to me what was written in John 8, 34 through 36, where Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in a family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." I am finding that as I am set free from past sins and the desire to continue in sin today, that I'm able to open up to my wife in a manner that has never been available, that I've never been able to in the past. And I'm able to carry the good news to those around me in ways that I would have never believed possible with grace and mercy. I am active at Celebrate Recovery meetings and activities, sponsoring some men and maintaining a relationship with my sponsor. As a side note to that, you know, I wrote this testimony probably 2 years ago, and I didn't update it for tonight because it was last minute. But in the last probably 8 months or so, I broke away from my sponsor. You know, things were going okay, and there was no real big issues that we needed to deal with, and, you know, ran into him every now and again, but really wasn't meeting with him on an ongoing basis. And what I found was that as I neglected to attend to my sobriety, as I neglected to attend to my recovery, I start running out of steam. You know, I sponsor a couple of guys, and it doesn't take too long, and I don't have anything to offer. So, you know, I've started meeting with my sponsor again, and I like it. I like it. The funny part is that I always get something from every meeting I attend. I actually accidentally attended a small group meeting for men with same-sex attractions. I wasn't sure what I was going to get from that meeting, as this has never been one of my issues. However, I came away from that meeting with a clear understanding that while the issues may be different, the feelings, behaviors, and emotions associated with the hurt, habit, or hang-up are all the same. The attenders at that meeting had similar reactions to what I have, and their solutions applied to me also. Because I'm active in CR, I get to participate in the recovery of those around me and see Jesus work in their lives in very obvious ways. You know, my wife and I are ministry leaders, co-leaders at our Celebrate Recovery in Newark. And what's kind of fun is, you know, in our business, I'm the president, so I get to have the final say, and we have discussions, of course, but when push comes to shove, I get to have the final say. In Celebrate Recovery, we've reversed the roles, and she's really the ministry leader, and I'm a co-leader. And so when push comes to shove, she gets to make the decision. And it's good for both of us. You know, it's good for me to make sure that I'm not being a bully and just having it always my way all the time. And it's good for her to have the leadership and be able to walk through that whole process. I invite each of you to get involved and stay involved in your Celebrate Recovery group through attending meetings, as well as taking service positions, getting into the team positions of the, you know, your meeting leadership, you know, the TEAM, teachers, encouragers, assimilators. You're all capable and able to be of service, and your recovery will benefit from it. God bless you. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to share what God is doing in me.
When I got sober, I attended a group called Celebrate Recovery. And it's a long story, but I ended up at a meeting and I was still addicted when I started. And I started attending weekly Thursday night meetings. And that was the first time that I had ever heard of these meetings. Long story short, I ended up going to these meetings for a couple of years. And then I started helping lead these meetings. Well, I moved away from my home meeting. And when I did, I thought, you know, I should start a Celebrate Recovery. Because where I am right now, there isn't one, like in this whole city. If you go to their website, which I'm going to post down there, it'll have like a list of major cities and all the locations that they do hold meetings. So that'll be nice if anybody's interested in looking. But anyway, I kept pushing the idea off and pushing it off and pushing it off. Well, someone had asked me this morning, I had coffee with someone, and I had mentioned Celebrate Recovery, and they casually said, well, what do you think about starting one sometime? And I thought, oh, it's coming back again, you know? And I only avoid it because I'm stubborn, and sometimes I still have a little bit of fear of what I am capable of doing, even though I know the book like the back of my hand, you know? Ah. So anyway, I wanted to share. This is a book. Wow, this is really old. It's called Stepping Out of Denial into God's Grace. And I dug it out today because I had talked in... about it this morning about how awesome this program is. And I want to share, if you happen to be watching this and you are addicted to something, or you know, whether it's drugs or gambling or pornography, or you're addicted to just being, you know, whatever. And when I say addicted, I use it loosely. What if you have a habit of something that's holding you back, which I say from bondage to freedom. When I say bondage, what I mean is anything that's holding you down and making your life difficult and hard and like you're just trudging along. This program helped me to start unpacking some of those things, because not only was I was an addicted person, but long before that, I was a very broken little girl, you know, and there's sexual abuse and divorce and drugs and all kinds of things that, you know, affected who I was. And these are things that I never really realized I was holding on to. Those kind of things affect everyone different. And some people, like, can let it go and just move on and kick ass in life, and some people hold on to it, and you know, I turned into this like cold, empty, emotionless person, and I put on a good game face, let me tell you. But so this program, the reason why it's amazing is because what it will help you do is it systematically helps you like pinpoint things and that you never really let go, or that maybe you don't even know you're holding on to it. But it helps you to kind of just sort through it all, look at it, accept it, and move on. And it also parallels each point with certain verses in scripture. And it is set up in a way that you could do it with a group. And so everybody's kind of bouncing everything off of one another and learning how to trust and share. And it is just amazing. And I spent a year in this book, and that's what you're supposed to do. And afterward, you know, you can look back at the beginning of the book and you can literally see tangible evidence of how far you have come. And everybody who's addicted, who might be watching this, knows that there are days when you look in the mirror and your eyes are so empty and you see nothing and you feel nothing and you think nothing. And that feeling sucks. And I don't care what you say right now, it sucks. And it's lonely. And this book, this whole program, will help you because God's a part of it, and I truly believe that. That's why it's different than AA and NA. And in my heart, I know that's why it's as successful as it is. And that's what I want to close with, is whether you're a person who has a lot of support from your family, or you're a person like me who has had no one standing there saying, hey, and you know, you want me to go with you, or, you know, I had a little bit, but they weren't people that were in my immediate family. Don't let that get you down. Whether you walk through Celebrate Recovery doors alone or with your mom or your aunt or your cousin or some person you just met, they will welcome you and they will quickly become people who you can trust. So like I said, I just wanted to share this program, Celebrate Recovery, with everyone. And that's all. I mean, if you're interested, go to the website and look up your location, your city, find one near you, and just go. Be brave and walk through those doors. And you don't even have to talk if you don't want to. Just go and see what it's all about. Give it a chance, you know? It's all you can do. Just try. Because nobody can make you walk through those doors, and nobody should have to talk you into it. When you're ready, look it up and go. Bye.
He came down and rescued me as I drowned in the depths of the sea. I was surrounded by my enemies, but he came down.
I felt like God was telling me that I needed to forgive myself, and you know, I can love myself and I can forgive myself. If God can forgive me, then I can forgive me.
Celebrate Recovery, I think, for me at this point in my life, has answered a question that I have asked God over and over as to why. And so when the opportunity came for me to be a facilitator in Celebrate Recovery, I was familiar with the program and I thought, this is the answer to my why. As it would be, I do have a young lady that has recently experienced depression, and I can share with her because I know what she's going through. And when she says it's a struggle to get up in the morning, I know what it's like to wake up in the morning and say, oh Lord, it's morning, you know, what am I going to do?
Oh, I was surrounded by my enemy.
It's been helpful in helping me get free from some things that I've been carrying around that in some cases I didn't even know I was still carrying around.
If it were called Celebrate Christ, I think I'd be even happier. But right now it's Celebrate Recovery for us. Doing other recovery programs, I've helped with AA programs and other programs in my counseling field, and this one's different because Christ is the center.
I drowned in the depths of the sea. I was surrounded by my...
Well, we begin the meeting as a large group with all of us together. We have our praise time with our songs. The time when we get our hearts ready for what's going to take place in our small groups. The small groups can be pretty intense at times.
we're not all perfect. In the church, sometimes we tend to look at each other and think, boy, they've got it all together, and then you want to hide your own area of pain.
There's a lot of fellowship. We begin with a worship time together, but people come early. There's fellowship in coming early. There's fellowship during the worship sessions, and of course we get together with our groups. People just don't want to leave. I mean, the program's over at 9, and everybody's out promptly by 10:30.
My life is better now. I just know what to do every day, and I know how much to do every day, and that's very freeing.
See, guys, that at the beginning of the year, this was a problem in a relationship, maybe. And during the year, the relationship has changed. They've been able to put relationships back together.
I had gone through secular counseling in the past for some severe abuse. And you don't have that support. You don't have the commitment of other people to you or to Christ and that bond. And for me personally, that's so, so important.
And I actually can talk to my father, which was a physical and mental abuser of me. And he could call me and I call him. And I could actually say I love him, which I'd never been able to do before.
My voice, he came down and rescued me.
I would say maybe balance.
One word.
I think freedom.
I would use the word freedom.
Put it in one word.
Well, it's healing.
Belonging.
A second chance.
That's three words.
Another chance. Two
words.
Take a chance. One word. Relationships.
Relationships.
Enlightening.
It's in one word. I would say it's Christ.
Jesus.
Peace.
Boy, come here. I say, come here.
Get in here. Boy, didn't I tell you to get in here?
You know what? I don't even know why she had you. I hate you. I can't stand you.
You know what? I hate you.
I hate her and I hate you.
With every breath in my body, I hate you just like your worthless father. I can't stand you. I wish I never even had you. You get on my nerves. You just, oh my God.
I've never seen such a punk in my life. Get out of here.
Nothing. You're just new. You're useless. I hate you so much. I wish you were dead.
Hi, I'm Pastor Hondell Smith. What you just saw was someone who has experienced a lot of hurt and a lot of pain. When I look back at my life, that was me. Social rejection, verbal abuse, it was a lot of pain. What ended up happening was that I was a hurt man. And as a result, I began to hurt others through control, through verbal abuse. What's your issue? I submit to you that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us have hurt people and we've been hurt. Man, I am so glad that God has provided a process in which we can take a spiritual inventory of all those that we may have hurt and those that may have hurt us. Find a way to get to the root cause of our issues you know? So what? You can't stop the drug addiction, you can't stop the pornography. Well, the root cause is really not pornography. The root cause could be social rejection. Man, I'm so delighted that God has found a process and given us a way through the road to recovery to help us to deal with those root causes. To get right with God, get right with ourselves, get right with others, so that we can help others. Man, I'm so glad that I've gone through this process of recovery. Come on, let's head on this road to recovery together. This is the place to be. God has a wealthy place for you. Let's head on up.
I've had quite a few hurts, habits, and hang-ups in my life. I guess one of the most devastating issues was that I was in a domestic marriage situation with a lot of hurt, pain, abuse of every kind. And I learned to bury and carry my issues and not tell anyone about it, not believing that anyone would really understand or be able to help me with it. But through Celebration Recovery, I have found that it is so much freedom in being transparent and having a place of safety and confidentiality where you can truly share the issues of your heart, even the pains of your past.
I thought I had problems. I thought I had hurts, habits, and hang-ups. I did. But by dealing with Celebrate Recovery inside, I am now free to express what God has done in my life, miraculous changes. I'm now able to live free from lying, free from hypocrisy, free from masquerades. Celebrate Recovery does not allow me to be angry. I'm angry with the old me, but I'm satisfied with what God is doing in me and the changes that He is making in me.
When I first came in here, I had a hardened heart. I wouldn't talk to nobody and I wouldn't share anything. But hearing other people's testimonies, and I found out that I had a lot of the same problems as them, so I started opening up after time. Secondly, it got me more in tune with God.
I've actually been in recovery since 1998 in classic 12-step programs. I've been going along with it and going to a lot of meetings, and I've worked through probably 8 of the steps, but I didn't have that focus for one thing on Jesus Christ as my Savior, and that has really made a lot of difference.
I'm recovering from drug addiction and road rage and anger.
Recovery life for me has been tremendous, because in my recovery I've been delivered from drug addiction and alcoholism and all kinds of other things after I got rid of those habits. I've been delivered from smoking and other things you can just imagine, things that people do when they're addicted to drugs and alcohol.
Being there listening to other people's testimony and listening to what they've gone through, and it lets me know that I'm just not alone. As a person that was abused as a child, one of the things I'm looking forward is I don't want to see children abused and hurt. So I want to help others be able to deal with the issues that I've been dealing with and overcome them. So I'm looking forward to overcoming all of my issues and being a help to others to help them overcome what I've overcome.
And I have recovered from several things. The root of it, social rejection.
So your life is broken. You're looking for a way to get through. What do you do? There's a process. I'm thinking that process has to do with experiencing God's grace in your life. We don't deserve the things that God gives us. And really understanding God's truth to kind of correct the stinking thinking in my life or in your life. And then really finding a way to acknowledge that, you know, this doesn't happen overnight. It's going to take some time. It's a process. And clearly you're going to need someone to share with openly and honestly. Well, at Celebrate Recovery, there's a process. We're all broken. We all need help. And this process will help you to kind of walk your way through a place, a safe place, to share the things that you've never shared with anyone. That could have been that rape. Could have been that abuse. It could have been, oh, I don't know. Whatever the issue is, God has a process. Check this out.
As well as the praise and worship and the testimonial or teaching and, you know, going through the steps and everything, we also have a step study group. And that's something that is really making a difference, as I'm able to have an accountability group of the other guys in the group. And we're going through the steps now. And that's, you know, in a year from now, I hope to be completely through the steps.
I appreciate how the recovery ministry is set up and how the leaders in the ministry are focused on not trying to fix someone, not trying to heal someone, but just letting God do the work. Help me understand how God sees me and how he wants me to see me, as opposed to how the enemy sees me. Sometimes the enemy wants to come in and try to lie to us and make us believe that there's nothing that can cure our situation. There's nothing that can heal our situation. Our hurts and our habits and our hang-ups are there for life. But through the ministry, I found out that that's not true. We know that God doesn't promise, and the Bible doesn't promise, that we won't have trials and tribulations in our lives. And I've had some trials and tribulations recently in my life, and it has enabled me to share my problems and my issues with the brothers in my group, and has let me know that I'm not the only one going through some of the issues that I've gone through. And that through my testimony and through my sharing, I'm able to help someone else as well as heal myself.
Celebrate Recovery means to me, I found it to be a place where I can go and openly share some hurts and some issues that I've hidden inside, some that I did not want to deal with. And I found that I could come here and share, not be judged, allow myself to get free.
It has helped me face up to the truth of who I am as a child, as a person, and I am a child of God. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. He has saved me and is saving me every day, and is helping me to look at myself and my hurts, habits, and hang-ups, and be honestly try to face them and deal with them. And too often I choose to run away from them and medicate them. And Celebrate Recovery, he just keeps drawing me back to this program and to himself, through this program and to the people here. I go to at least two meetings on a fairly regular basis, and I find that when I miss one, I don't feel good. Something's wrong, something's missing. So it's been very uplifting and encouraging to me, an addict to various things. To encounter Celebrate Recovery in the first place, and to keep coming back. And I praise God for it.
Man, what an exciting place to be. A place of healing, a place of wealth, a place of land, milk, and honey. The woman that pressed her way towards Jesus and touched the garment and was healed of that issue of blood that she had for so many years. What's your issue? God has a healing place for you, and now a wealthy place for you. Man, when I went through this recovery program, God healed my marriage. He put me on the road to a place I've never been before. My dreams are now coming through. I'm going to places I've never been. I'm telling you, it's an awesome thing. Is it this road to wealth? Is it that road to wealth? Is it a place where you can find your dreams that will come back as a result of the suppression and the rejection? God wants you on this journey. He wants you healed so you can help someone else, because we're healed to help. Let's do it.
Ah, this is for everybody who's been restored. D. Lawrence coming at you. Get up, come on, y'all.
My ministry in recovery, I'm a part of the praise team, and I love being part of the praise team. Part of my problem has been isolation, and just being with the group of people that we sing with, it's been good. And just ministering, it's just been truly a blessing. It's been kind of freeing. It's kind of getting me out of my box and helping me to become a whole person.
After recovery ministry, there's still recovery to be done. There's still work to be done on myself and for the people around me. I work with the young men at the Helping Up Ministry, which is a ministry specifically dedicated to helping brothers on the road to recovering their lives after they have conquered substance abuse. And it is a lifelong process, this recovery plan. And they have even blessed my life as they commit to do the right things on a day-to-day basis.
Life after being in recovery for 3 years has really been a true blessing and a miraculous change in my life. God has really just used me to minister to others, and I never thought that I would be one who would be ministering to anyone. But being obedient to God and giving Him complete control of my life has really allowed me to be healed in areas of my life that I struggled with for many years.
After recovery, I want you to know that God has delivered me from social rejection. I sit in all of His goodness and love and approval. I am now director of the MCIW Prison Ministry.
As I go in to serve and to work with the men that are physically locked in the prison, I found out that they are freer than I am. I thought I was going to serve them. I thought I was going to minister to them. I ended up getting the full scope of ministry. And I thank God for that opportunity, for Him to reveal Himself to me in a new and different way.
So I'm one of the facilitators in the small groups that we have of men that are in prison and Jessup, JOIC maximum prison. It's an annex there where we have people that are there for life. And they minister to us and we minister to them. I've learned a lot more from the men of God that are confined to prison than they've learned from me. But I feel called to do it. I think I'm almost addicted. We go on Friday nights, and if for some reason or other I don't go, I don't feel right about it.
When I got more in terms of God, God wanted me to open up a homeless shelter and become nonprofit. And I just thought that was too big for me. But God got the first part done, and I know that He's going to get the whole plan finished. Coming to Celebrate Recovery been the best choice I ever made in my life. Everybody had hurts, habits, and hang-ups.
It's been a year. I've gone through these 12 steps and in close proximity with these brothers and exposed my life. And now what? Well, it's sort of like having hip surgery of some sort, because after you do the major surgery and you go in and you deal with the major issues in your life, now it's like a rehabilitation phase where now we're dealing with some other issues, because there's always something to deal with. But it's a rehab, and not only is it a rehab, because now it's like I'm beginning to use muscles that I've never used before. I didn't know they were there because they were all covered up by my hurts, habits, and hang-ups. So God is teaching me now to use new parts of my life to stretch, as if it were, and to, you know, come into something new and to know Him in a new way. And it's a rehabilitation, and not only is it a rehab, but it's also helping other people and letting them know that, hey, you have no idea where I came from to where I am right now. And it may not look like it's far to you, but boy, it's an ocean to me. So there is life after recovery, and even though we are always recovering for something, thank God it's not the stuff I was recovering from yesterday.
That gives me a lot of hope, and then I can turn around and start leading others through the steps. So I'm very thankful to Celebrate Recovery.
I encourage everyone to come. It will change your life, and it will make you go out and help other people and help change their lives. Thank you.
Through the Word of God and working the principles and having a group to support you and encourage you and be there for you, that there is healing, restoration, and wholeness through traveling down the road of recovery and having others travel along with you to pray for you and encourage you.
Celebrate Recovery has revolutionized my life, and it can revolutionize yours too. God bless you and keep you.
And I just thank the Lord for this ministry, for its leadership team, and for the people who participate too, who bless my lives as we interact in the grocery stores or in the movies. And I just love this ministry.
I'm just thankful for their ministry. I'm just thankful for it.
Just opening up and allowing the guys to see what God can do if he's given the opportunity. And that's what Celebrate Recovery means and does for me. And I am truly thankful to God for being here. Thank you.
Thank you for letting me share.
He suffered that we might be healed.
I am healed.
From the inside out. Jonathan Nelson and Purpose. Y'all bless you.
Disappointment.
That's right.
I am healed.
Say that again.
I found that, you know, during the time when this whole journey started, that my fears had me consumed and I was completely paralyzed.
I was coming to the end of seminary. I had 4 church job offers that had gone through all the interviews and all that stuff, and then my wife left and my band, out of the 4 of us, we were close to getting signed, and out of the 4 of us, 3 of us were going through divorce all at the same time.
Everybody has something to recover from. No matter how well your life is, like I said, I'm 55 years old, I thought life was sweet. And in the process, the last few years, I lost my house, I lost my friends, I lost a ton of money. Because I kept thinking, well, I got this under control. I'm going to get better. And I was so busy trying to fix myself, I didn't realize that trying to fix myself was the problem.
And I knew I needed help. I kept hearing about this Celebrate Recovery program, and finally I was desperate enough to give it a try because everything I had tried didn't work. And so I was ready for something different.
Celebrate Recovery has taken me to a different place where I continue to work my steps. And right now, through the step study, as I work my 4th step, I get to see a whole nother place of healing that the Lord's taking me to show me with love. As he puts his hand on me and he just loves on me, he shows me with peace how to just walk through these struggles or confusing moments or frustrations.
It's a funny thing, I was already volunteering at a recovery program in my previous church, and I had no clue that I needed recovery because I was not what you think of as a typical recovery person.
Well, it really doesn't matter if it's alcohol, drugs, pornography, I think is the biggest one. Whatever it is you're using to medicate your pain, it really doesn't matter. It's all the same because the underlying is the same.
Actually, only 1 in 3 people that are in Celebrate Recovery have an addiction. So Celebrate Recovery is for anybody who needs any kind of healing or just distant from the Lord and just wants to be closer to God.
We can be honest with anything and share anything in our lives. It's not going to leave that room. And that's a given because we're all in the same boat there. You know, we're all depending on each other for that anonymity.
This was a completely new feeling walking in there and hearing hope, hearing something different. I know for me it had to be a safe place because if I had gone in there and been thumped with the Bible or been told to read these books by some author. Really, if anyone had tried to fix me, I would have been out immediately.
These things were wearing me down. I was dragging all this heavy load on my back. And now I have brothers in Christ to walk with me in that journey.
And that's what Celebrate Recovery is. It's all about love, you know, and feeling God's grace and us learning what God's grace brings to us and us getting to share that and teach other people to feel the same comfort.
Hi, my name is Bill Ponch Alvis, and I'm a changed life. We were a military family. God was just somebody that you would pray to occasionally at funerals or if one of Dad's friends died. Well, I started going to college. I was going to go into the military. My father taught me out of it and went to college. I got a job as a police officer. Through my career, as an officer, I was became very self-centered and selfish. I went through two marriages and two divorces. The enemy started isolating me to the point I had some addictions that I was not dealing with very much at all. And eventually he got me isolated to the point of suicide. I was getting ready to eat a gun, and it was like the Lord called me on it. He said, you know, what is it, Bill? Is it going to be life or is it going to be death? I think that night that I made that cry out to God, that's when things really started to change in my life. I prayed for a church home and was eventually led to Crossroads here. I wanted to minister to others that have suffered, and I wanted to help them. I go into the prisons down at Lexington. I go because that's where my heart is. It's wonderful going in there and seeing changed lives of inmates while they're still in prison. This last time we went to the prison, which was Monday night, and one of the guys in there was somebody that I had arrested early on in his life, and he was the classical mess, and he came up to me and he says, you know, I knew you were a Norman cop. He said, you'd arrested me at one time. He says, I really want to pray with you. And so we did. It was wonderful. Having a relationship with Christ is the single most important thing that any person can do for themselves in their lives while we're here on this world. I didn't know that I could have that before I started coming to this church. Well, this church is a second home to me. This church is a refreshing to me. This church is a blessing to me. The people in this church are a blessing to me, and they're like my extended loving family. This church is my second home.
We don't have to live very long to experience hurt. We all hurt others and ourselves. Out of that hurt, habits and hang-ups develop that can hold us back from the authentic joy and freedom we crave. We want to change, but often fall back into our old ways. Celebrate Recovery is a Christ-centered 12-step program for those of us who are ready to embark on a journey of real and lasting change.
It was about almost 3 years ago during a church service. They mentioned this new group that was starting at our church.
I was attending Creekside Church, and I saw a pamphlet for Celebrate Recovery in the bulletin, and because of the struggles I was going through at that time of my life, I decided to check it out.
In the past, you mentioned God, I was leaving.
But I knew my life was totally messed up, and I needed some truth.
And but there I gained an understanding of God.
And I knew I needed to get healthy. And so I came to Celebrate Recovery.
My first recovery meeting I went to, I cried all the way there, all the way through the meeting, and all the way home again.
I didn't want to go. It was happening at a church that I'd been a member of for over 20 years.
I came through the door broken, very wounded, bitter, angry gal.
Well, I definitely wasn't consistent. I came for about a year, and then, happenstances in life, I stopped coming.
I felt I could be myself, and that's what I needed. I needed to be genuine, open, and honest.
It's changed me. I'm a new person because of the experience.
I didn't have to sing, and I chose not to sing. But I started listening to the words in the music, and it brought so much comfort to me.
Every time I came back, I felt welcomed, I felt loved, I didn't feel judged.
It's still a place that I can come and just take off my mask and be real about what's going on in my life.
My sponsor cares enough about me to be honest and be real with me.
That hopelessness, never have to feel it again.
Once you have an accountability team as well, you know that it's not just for you and it's not just for Christ, but it's for other people too, the reason that you're there.
The Celebrate Recovery material is based on God's Word, and so we get taught from God's Word that He cares about us.
I could have lost everything, including my life in my darkest hour,
I had past hurts. I had felt victimized.
It's a safe, secure place to come and say, I need some help.
It's amazing that I have Bible studies with my father now. And that we're building a relationship that I didn't really see possible.
Where can we go on this planet and find that safe, secure place? In my 47 years, the only place I could find myself ever go.
You do not have to have an addiction to something in order to attend Celebrate Recovery. For me, I started attending because I had hurt.
I don't think I ever had, you know, really true, honest, deep relationships until I started coming to CR.
The connection that I have with God now and the relationship, I wouldn't trade it for anything.
But for me, the hardest thing that I ever did in my whole life ended up being the very thing that gave my life the most purpose and the most joy.
We start to be able to understand that we can change, that there is hope, that others can change.
You can just continue the way you are, or you can experience change.
So if you're struggling, if you aren't even sure what to do, I would just suggest just come up to Celebrate Recovery and just give it a chance.
Jesus Christ is here. He's our higher power. And he's the one who heals us. He's the one who brings us together, carries us through. And we just have to reach up and grab his hand and just hang out for the ride.
So I encourage you to be a part of Celebrate Recovery.
The Apostle Paul said that he had become all things to all men, so that by all possible means he may save some. Anything to get the job done. You know, I've watched a lot of ministries come and go through the churches over the years, but the one that stands out in my mind more than any of them is called Celebrate Recovery. It gives hope to the hopeless. It's hard work. It takes a lot of dedication, long hours, sitting down with your neighbor that bad times have fallen upon him, most of the time brought upon him by himself with the help of the evil one. But the guys and gals with Celebrate Recovery, and I've traveled from one end of these United States to the other, they have done a terrific job. When I go to a church and speak, and I know that there's a Celebrate Recovery there, it makes me happy, happy, happy to be there. I'm Phil Roberts with Duck Dynasty, and I'm behind you, Celebrate Recovery. Good work. God's with you. So am I.